I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart. I've got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart, and I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart. I've got the wonderful love of my blessed Redeemer way down in the depths of my heart.
Where?
Down in the depths of my heart.
Where?
Down in the depths of my heart. I've got the wonderful love of my blessed Redeemer way down in the depths of my heart.
Where?
Down in the depths of my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart.
Amen. All right, children, who are you doing children's prayer? Cole?
And just read them.
You did the hand six things.
I don't know.
Just read them. Contact rules. Honor God.
Honor God.
Follow directions.
Follow directions.
Be a friend.
Be a friend.
Participate.
Participate.
Listen to your teacher.
Listen to your teacher.
Listen to your teacher.
Listen to your teacher.
Stick with your buddy.
Stick with your buddy.
Stick with your buddy.
Stick with your buddy.
Walk in a building.
Walk in a building.
And sing really loud.
And sing really loud.
We're still going.
Did it help?
Yeah.
Philippians 4:6.
Do not be anxious.
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and patience.
Petition.
With thanksgiving present, your request to God.
Now we're praying.
Everybody, bow your heads and close your eyes. Father God, thank you for watching over us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for all these people here. And thank you for having clothes on us and a meal in front of us. Thank you for having us another day in life. And thank you for all these people here to see and to worship about you. And thank you for everything you've done about us. And thank you for dying on the cross for us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving everybody a family and to live a free day in here. And thank you for Sunday. Thank you for everything you've done for us. Thank you for your son. Thank you for loving us. And please help the people that need to be helped. Please watch over poor people that's on the sidewalk. They need clothes, they need a roof over them, and they need a meal in front of them. Please help the people that need help with their family, or please help them if they need to go to the doctor. Please help us to win a war, and for people can go see their family, and for their child can be happy to see their family again. And thank you for everything you've done for us. Thank you for dying on the cross for us. And thank you for all these people here and praying for you. And thank you for making this great day in life. And thank you for everything you've done for us. And thank you for being here for us. And thank you for everything you've done for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
I got it.
And now we're going to dismiss for children's worship.
All right, let's be standing as we dismiss for children's worship as well. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great. How great is our God, and age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
Amen. Please be seated.
Come back next week and you guys will hear some great preaching. He'll be up here slinging it. So this is just get him started, get him pumped up so he'll get to rolling. Glad you're here. Thankful that you're here. And all you young faces here to serve our Almighty God. Great is our God. Amen, church. Great is our God. I'm going to be looking at John chapter 3, and I'm going to be moving to John chapter 4. Let me lead us in a prayer, all right? Thank you, Father, that we get to read the Word. And God, the words that we get to read, how powerful they are. And thank you, God, that we get to apply them in our lives. And God, I want to be a better listener. And I want to listen where I get to share, and I want to grow up and be a man of action, a man of faith, and a man of honesty before you. God, we read a lot of folks that are not honest, but God, I want to be honest. And somebody in this audience may need to place some trust in you, and I pray that happens. But thank you, God, for this contact family and all the teams that showed up to serve this week. Thank you for taking care of them. And God, I pray for a truckload of buddies to show up starting tomorrow. Thank you for forgiveness. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You remember John chapter 2, where he talked about John chapter 1, he chose his disciples. John chapter 2, he turned the water to wine, and that means I can drink all the hooch I want to. Amen? That causes me to justify it. He turned the water into wine, but I miss the whole boat when I do that, don't I? Because at the end of that, in that chapter, it talks about Jesus performed that miracle in Cana of Galilee, and he revealed his glory. First miracle, right there, he revealed his glory. Second miracle we're going to look at later on at the end of chapter 4, and we'll see his second miracle. If we travel all the way through the book of John, we're going to see some greater, all of them are great miracles that we're going to see that took place. All right, chapter 3, and I love chapter 3, I love all of them. A clown by the name of Nicodemus showed up. He's a Pharisee. He's got it together. He's a member of the Sanhedrin, Supreme Court. He's got it going. But he asked Jesus, What must a man do to enter the kingdom of heaven? And he didn't listen. He didn't care. I don't know that he didn't care, but he did not listen. You guys have never done that. How we sometimes don't pay attention. Nicodemus wasn't paying attention because Jesus told him, you must be born of the water and the what? Spirit. Must be born of the water and the what? Spirit. Not just water, not just spirit. Born of the water and the spirit, baptized into Christ, and have that new birth. And as Jesus shared that on that powerful occasion. Chapter 4, we see the powerful testimony that Jesus shared as another Pharisee shows up. And here's this woman at the well. She's a Samaritan. Jesus is a Jew. And she immediately looks at him and said, hey, you're a Jew. You're a man. And what are you doing here with me? Because it was against the law. Pharisee said, hey, you can't do that. But guess what Jesus did? He is a rule breaker. He followed the laws of God to serve and to love people. And I love what she said to him. She said, you're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan. Later on, she said, called him sir. Again, she calls him sir. Later on, calls him a prophet. What's going on? And the beautiful part, all of it's beautiful, says, you are the Messiah. How did that happen? Because here's this guy that's not even supposed to be with this Samaritan woman. He's a Jew. He's not supposed to be seen with this old woman. And he tells her, I'm going to give you the water that you'll never run thirsty again. I need that water. I want that water. What about you? You want that living water. And that living water that God has given us. And I love that story whenever she called him Messiah. The other part that I love, the disciples are out. They went to Mickey D's to get some groceries. And they come back, and they've got the French fries, and they tell Jesus, hey, Lord, you need to eat your fries before they get what? Before they get cold, you need to hurry up and eat those fries. And what did Jesus say? My food is not Mickey D's. Is that true? And I need that same attitude. Instead of saying, well, I can make it if I get down there and get some fries, and there's a particular place that I get those fries. Is that true? You guys know where the best fries are and the best Dr. Pepper if you want to go to heaven. But Jesus said, my food is not that. And then he says, why are you talking about that? You know, it's an awkward situation for the disciples, isn't it? But it's not an awkward situation for Jesus. Why? Because his ministry is to change hearts. And you and I get to do that. Amen? We get to change hearts, and all you people that are going to be here in the morning get to change hearts. Monday night, you'll say, man, why'd I come? Tuesday night, why'd I come? Wednesday, you say, why'd I come? I'm sick and tired of that clown. Man, they're cussing me. They're calling me bad names. Why did I even show up? Keep letting God work your heart and working their heart. My food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me to do this work. Amen? Why are we here today? We baptized somebody into Christ, and I've never watched that person go home from that baptistry. I've never watched them go to heaven from that baptistry. The other day, Roger baptized an old woman into Christ, and I didn't see her go straight to heaven. Somebody baptized another old woman into Christ in that stinking river. And all their sins are washed away. Right there. Hit it again. Sprout, hit it again. Look at that.
Yeah.
Man, what's the deal? Why are they so happy? Is there any more to that? The Son, the Holy Spirit, for the remission of all your sins. Be raised to walk in newness of life. Did she hear that guy?
No. Never be any clearer.
Yes. Son, what I want you to see in that picture right there, you can't see it. There's two guys in that picture. I don't have them. See that guy right here? Look straight on. There's a bald-headed dude that doesn't have a shirt. Got him? That guy joined our party, and he came up and he said, hey, you might as well, mind if if I join, Tree, you remember that occasion where you tried to throw this cat in the river? How'd that work? Not too well. That guy, he said, hey, can I join? There's a clump of trees from here to that wall, and he walks over there. Now you see him in the picture. He said, man, I like what you guys are doing. You know what he just said? He loves what God is doing, and he witnessed those two souls being united with God. Amen? Amen? Amen, church. Isn't that the glory? Isn't that what Jesus is telling Nicodemus? Isn't that what Jesus is telling the woman at the well? She's a young lady, and he's a Jew. But yet Jesus had the compassion in his heart to love him and spend time with her. Excuse me. Spend time with her to let her know she was valuable and important and significant. Now that brings us to the end of the chapter. Chapter 4. Now look at your outline, piece of paper you have, all right? Before I read that, let me share something. You know, statistics, how do you say that? Say that we will possibly live to the ripe old age of 70. Another 20 years, I'll be there. I'm praying for another 20. Blondie, you got me another 20. You didn't hear what she said. I'm glad they bleeped that. 20 more, Blondie. Think we can make it? But that's what statistics say. We can make it to 70. But guess what? Not a lot of folks don't make it. Let me share a sad story. A guy by the name of Nicholas, one bright Sunday afternoon, a numbing telephone call brought news of a mountain climbing accident. The bereaved father reflects on the painful loss of his son. Gone from the face of the earth, I wait for a group of students to cross the street, and suddenly I think, he's not there. I go to a ball game and find myself singling out the 25-year-old. None of them is he. In all the crowds and streets and rooms and churches, schools and libraries, gatherings of friends in our world, on all the mountains, I will not find him. Only his absence. Silence. Was there a letter from Eric today? When did Eric say he would call? Not only silence, absence and silence. When we gather now, there's always someone missing. His absence as present as our presence, his silence as loud as our speech. Still 5 children, but one always gone. When we're all together, his silence is loud. We're not all together because he's gone. It's a never mess that is so painful. Never again to be here with us. Never to sit with us at a table. Never to travel with us. Never to laugh with us. Never to cry with us. Never to embrace us as he leaves for school. And never to see his brothers and sister Mary and all the rest of our lives. We must live without him. The reason why I shared that, because today in our lesson on that sheet of paper that you've got, I want you to pay attention to this father. And I want you to pay attention to the other main character, and that of Jesus. Let me read the text, starting in verse 43. Notice the title, From Trouble to Trust. From Trouble to Trust. Will we ever be without trouble? Wrong question, isn't it? It's a wrong question. But so what do I get to do? I get to grow and build my trust. Is that true, Brenda May? Is that true, Shirley, that we get to build our trust? Let's see what the text says. After 2 days, he left for Galilee. Jesus knew well from experience that a prophet is not respected in the place where he grew up. So when he arrived in Galilee, the Galileans welcomed him but only because they were impressed with what he had done in Jerusalem during the Passover feast. Not that they really had a clue about who he was or what he was up to. Now let me pause right there. You notice where he was and they didn't respect him? Four SWs. SW. Some will. There's Jesus right here in these 4 points. Some will. Some won't. So what? You see Jesus in that right there? Some will, some won't. So what? And number four, someone's waiting. They don't respect him right there, but the Galileans welcomed him. What does that have to do with us? I'm not going to be like the, you remember the shoe salesman went to Africa. And he came back. He said, man, they don't wear any shoes. The other salesman went to Africa, and he did a TJ. Oh, man, look at all those feet. I can put some shoes on them. And he got after it, didn't he? Someone's waiting. I need that attitude. All right, continue in verse 46. We've got a curiosity crowd. He's back in Cana of Galilee, the place where he'd made the water into wine. Meanwhile, in Capernaum, there was a certain official from the king's court whose son was sick. And when he heard that Jesus had come from Judea of Galilee, he went and asked that he come down and heal his son, who was on the brink of death. Jesus put him off. Unless you people are dazzled by a miracle, you refuse to believe. Now, what I want to share with you right there, Jesus is trying to change their basic attitude. Is that us? To change my basic attitude? As long as I don't read the word, guess what's going to happen to this guy? My attitude is going to be rank and it's going to stink. I preached a funeral for a clown, and he wrote in his resolution before he died, he said, I want to be a daily Bible reader. Why did he say that? He wanted to make a commitment in that resolution to help his attitude to be what God wanted him to be. Second thing he wrote, I want to be a better son. Man, that is powerful. Those words were written in 1987. He's been dead 10 years. And those words are so much more powerful now, aren't they? Even though he's dead, they still... I'm going to hand those words to his mom and dad, I think. And the only reason I hesitate because I'm going to watch them explode as they'll be crying, hurting with pain from the loss of their son. From the loss of their son. In verse 49, but the court official wouldn't be put off. Come down, it's a life or death for my son. And Jesus simply replied, go home, your son lives. You talk about good news. That is good news, isn't it? The man believed the bare word Jesus spoke and headed home. On his way back, his servants intercepted him and announced, your son lives. He asked them what time he began to get better. They said, the fever broke yesterday afternoon at 1:00. And the father knew that there was that was the very moment Jesus had said, excuse me, your son lives. That sensed it. That clinched it. Not only he, but his entire household believed. That was now the second sign Jesus gave after having come from Judea to Galilee. Two things about the Christ. Number one is his grace, G-R-A-C-E. That man didn't deserve it, that son didn't deserve it, but that official, that father, would never quit, would he? Because he loved his family. He loved his family. He wants his family well. He wants his son well. But the official knew what Jesus had been doing. That's the same thing with us. People know what we're doing. And doing, making a difference. One, two, second house, third house, right across the street. One, there's one, two, third house. That lady would park 47 vehicles out in our parking lot because they'd take a cruise in a big old bus. And every time I'd see her, she'd say, "Man, I love what you guys are doing." How'd she know? She didn't come to church here. Next house, the guy didn't believe in God. He didn't want anything to do with God. He grew up in that house. That was his grandparents' house. That was that field out there where he went hunting and fishing all the time as a kid. But he wouldn't do anything with. There were some guys out on our basketball court, our basketball, and they'd tear it down. We'd put another one up. They'd tear it down. We had a swing set. They'd tear it down. Finally, that guy over there got sick and tired of the people tearing up all our equipment. So he walks out there, and he said, "Hey, guys, you need to quit tearing up our equipment." And they said, "What are you going to do about it, blankety blank?" He said, "I'll show you what I'm going to do about it." He walked inside and got his shotgun and fired it in the air. Those clowns haven't been back. You know why he did that? He said, "This is God's." Even though he didn't believe in God, he didn't want anything to do with God, but he respected what's taking place here. That's us. That's what we're doing. That's what Jesus did. And that official knew what Jesus, his track record, how he touched people, how he listened, how he loved. Amen? Man, we get to do that, don't we? And he knew, he had faith that Jesus healed his son from trouble to trust. That guy over there croaked. And they found his body 2 weeks later. Can you imagine that? But he would never, he had never come to this place. He'd never come inside. But he supported, he encouraged, and he said, "Ron, you need anything? You need my help? You need anything?" But he would never surrender. That official surrendered and listened to the Christ. Amen? Number one, because of grace. Did he deserve it? Do I deserve it? Do you deserve his grace? I don't deserve any of it. Can I buy it? Can I buy his grace? Can I earn his grace? Can I work enough? Can I haul 47 people a day? Will that get it? I won't touch it. I won't touch it. Because of the grace of God, he healed that son, and he healed that official. Second thing about Jesus, how powerful he is. He wasn't even with him. Wasn't even with that boy, was he? And he healed him. He said, "Your son lives." Man, wouldn't that be encouraging when we have somebody that's hurting like that from trouble to trust? And I need that lesson very deeply. Number Psalms 128. Psalm 128, all you who fear God, how blessed you are. How happily you walk on his smooth, straight road. You worked hard and deserve all you've got coming. Enjoy the blessing. Revel in the goodness. Your wife will bear children as a vine bears grapes. Your household lush as a vineyard. The children around your table as fresh and promising as young olive shoots. Stand in awe of God's yes. Oh, how he blesses the one who fears God. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. Camp Moe this year. It was an old woman there. About every 30 seconds, she's hollering, "Jesus!" How many times she do that, Daylene? Guess what the kids started doing? Soon as she'd say it, what'd the kids do? "Jesus!" We'd go anywhere, everywhere we'd go. What would she say? "Jesus." You know why? Because she'd been saved by the blood of the Lamb because of Jesus who died on the cross, and she believed it, and she lived it, and she loved it, and she shared it. We go to CC's all day in Springfield, Missouri, and she hollers, "Jesus!" What do the kids do? and that whole place hears about the Lord. And a lady come up to me and said, "Man, I like what all you guys are doing." I said, "I'm just eating pizza." But she knew there was a difference, didn't she? And that's what we get to do. We get to make a difference in people's hearts and people's lives. And every year, Muscles isn't here to defend himself. But every year, Muscles always says, "Hey, Babbitt, you going to the Dairy Queen?" So we go to the Dairy Queen. What do they say? Apple? Jesus! Everywhere we go. And it became contagious because somebody's love. Then we sing that song, "Down by the River." And that's what happened to those two precious souls that were baptized into Christ, down by the river, been baptized, washed my sins away. And Satan shows up as soon as they come up out of that water. He shows up, doesn't he? Because he doesn't want those ladies, those girls, to walk with him. The grace of God and how powerful he is. I'll never forget, I knocked on that door. And I asked for this lady who's in the hospital. And they looked at me, and they thumbed through their computer and said, we don't have her. I said, "Check it again." She thumbed through again, said, "We don't have her, sir." I'm looking around. I'm not going to leave till I find her. So I'm looking over there, and I see some offices, and I go over and knock on the door, and I said, "I'm looking for..." And they look, and what do they tell me? "She's not here." I still don't like it. So I go to the next set of offices, and I walk in there. And my name's not on the shingle. I'm not supposed to go in there, but they've got a doorknob, and so I grab it, and I walk in. And they say, What? "Can we help you, sir?" I said, "Yeah, I'm looking for..." Said, "Are you family?" I said, "No, I'm a minister." "We can't give you that information." I said, "Rats." So guess what I do? I keep looking. I said, "Where is the bone marrow transplant floor?" They told me, number 6. Go to the elevator. Punch that number 6 button. And I go to the nurse's desk. And I'm looking at that nurse, and I ask for Cindy. Cindy died at 8 o'clock. And I'm looking right over here at her room. She was right there. In the next room is another guy who used to preach right down here at Carbondale Church of Christ. He was in there in that room. And so I said, "Well, I'll go in there and encourage him and pray with him and read the word." And the first, as soon as I stuck my foot in that door, he said, "How is Cindy?" I said, "Rats. I don't want to tell him." Because they became buddies because they've gone through that bone marrow transplant and talked to anybody that's ever gone through that and how tough it is. And they became best of friends. The night before, all night long, my buddy Stan climbed up there in that bed with Cindy and held her. Just held her. Why did he hold her? All night long, 8 hours. People come in, Stan would stay right there in bed, holding his bride to take her last breath. Guys, we're seeing too many people that are taking their last breath and they don't even know it. At their house, she had painted on that Frady hole, that cellar door. As those teenage boys would wheel in there and make that turn and their headlights zero in on that cellar door, it said, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, in all your ways." Why did she put that on that stinking door? Because she wanted her sons to acknowledge.
And she told her husband, she said, Stan, your folks will not come to Jesus. They will never be baptized into Christ until she dies. I'm standing outside the baptistry. Stan is walking down those steps to go inside the baptistry to baptize his mother. And he says, Babbitt, I had to bury my wife so that my mother could live with Jesus. I had to bury my wife so that my dad could live with Jesus, and he baptized both of them. I had no idea his feelings as he experienced loving to baptize, to save his family, wanting mom and dad to be in Christ. But he had to lose his wife. What am I willing to give up? From trouble to trust. Am I willing to acknowledge him? There's folks here that are not Christians. Say, man, I can't make it. Nah, none of us can without the blood of the Lamb. Amen. Amen. We can't make it without the body of Christ. When I'm baptized into Christ, I need the body. I get to enjoy the body. I get to be with the body. Amen, church. What am I willing to give up so that one more soul, just one more, will go help them from trouble to trust in the Savior? Or we just come to church to say, hey, I punched my ticket, I'm going home, man. Let's go, let's get her done, man. When he paid the price, and I'll never forget standing there and watching Stan baptize his family and the tears of joy and the tears of pain because he had buried his wife. Maybe you're not a Christian, let me encourage you. Don't just ask the questions like old Nicodemus did. But get with it. Get with it. And follow him. We can assist you. We can help. We got 47 people who will be right here to help you today as we stand and sing. Won't you come?
Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Yes, I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step, you lead me, Lord, and I will follow you all of my days. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Yes, I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step, you lead me, Lord, and I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And step by step, you lead me, Lord, and I will follow you all of my days. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. He answers prayer. He answers prayer. He answers prayers. He's so good. to me, and I love him so. I love him so. I love him so. He's so good to me.
Amen. Please be seated.
This is a time that we as a family come together for praise and prayer. It's a time where we get to share the blessings of what God is doing in our life, but also through prayer and petition, we give our requests to God. And so we have a couple that we want to share with our family. Rita sends this. Becca, which is her daughter, was in the hospital this week and has been diagnosed with preeclampsia. She needs a lot of our prayers. The doctor says if she has the baby this soon that she will lose him. So please, please be in prayer for Becca. We're also praying for our brother Chuck. His granddaughter, I believe, her name is Chloe, is in a very particular situation and needs our prayers of safety, needs our prayers of clarity. And so the Lord knows exactly what's going on in that situation, and so we're asking, praying, pleading with God to intervene. Anybody else have anything that they would like to mention?
Holly had six shots in her back.
Holly. So she's recuperating right now. Six shots in her back. Okay.
Neighbor Dan.
Neighbor Dan, yep. Neighbor Dan. Anything from the East Side Church? Amen, Church. West Side, do we have anything? Downtown. Yeah, oh, sorry, Stan, sorry.
Like for you to our family in Springfield, our daughter, husband, granddaughter, they've all got COVID, or had COVID, and my name is Alex.
Thank you. We'll be praying there. Anything else from the West Side Church? Downtown. All right. I don't know. Is Sprout, you in the booth? If you could throw up our QR code. I just wanted to take this opportunity. If you all have any praise and prayer requests throughout the week, or even as we begin service, if you will go ahead and snap that, it'll take you to our website. It's a place where we can submit those praise and prayers throughout the week, actually really any time, and we will get those. I know that our cards, we run very few of printing those, but you can always access our praise and prayer card anytime, anywhere. So I just want to do a plug there. Do you have anything, 15, 11? Oh, yes, 11. We're going to pray for that tooth, okay? I know you're in a lot of pain. So our sister 11 right here, she is having some tooth pain. And so we're going to definitely pray for that. All right. Let's grab a hand. Let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Righteous God, Jehovah, Yahweh, Elohim, names in which we approach your throne with the reverence that you are holy, that you are mighty, that you are a God that has everything in your control. And we humbly approach your throne, understanding that your presence is always with us. And Father, we thank you for always being with us, that we rejoice with those who rejoice. And Father, we also weep with those who weep. Because, Lord, we understand that you are close to the brokenhearted. And so, Father, as we petition you and we pray and we give these things unto you, Father, we know that you have an understanding and that you're in control. But, Lord, we ask in a mighty way that you act and you intervene. Father, for Becca, as she is battling. And Father, as we understand that she is battling preeclampsia, Father, we pray in Jesus' name, the author of life, that you sustain that life. And Father, I pray that a miracle be done. Lord, we thank you for being already in this situation, Father. Father, we also pray in the situation of Chloe that, Father, you know exactly what's going on. And, Father, we know that the family around Chloe is hurting. And, Father, we just pray that you intervene. Father, for the safety, for the, Lord, just really for that situation, Father, we thank you for the courage of Chuck to come and plead with you, Lord, to intervene. And so, Father, we ask in Jesus' name that you be in this situation with Chloe. Father, for Holly, as she is recovering from the 6 shots, Lord, we just ask that you continue to heal her body. And, Father, I pray that she recovers well. Father, for neighbor Dan, as he continues to battle, Father, we pray that you reveal yourself in a mighty way to him. And, Father, that you continue to restore his mind. Father, we thank you. We thank you for being with neighbor Dan. Father, for the family in Springfield, we ask, as Stan is asking, that you continue to be with their health. Lord, we pray for their battles with COVID. And, Father, we just ask that you restore their health in Jesus' name. Father, for 11, as she is putting a smile on her face and she is here, we also understand, Lord, that she's in pain. And so, Father, we ask that you be with her tooth pain. And, Father, I pray that you that pain subsides and, Father, that she gets the help that she needs to alleviate that pain. Father, we thank you for hearing our prayers. We thank you that you are so close to us. Father, we understand that you are always near, that you'll never leave us, that you'll never forsake us. Father, we know, as Ron talked about today, that we can trust in you in every problem we have because you turn those problems into trust. And so, Lord, we thank you. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. God is good. And all the time. Amen. All the time. Just some announcements here. We got our second week of camp with a whole bunch of groups that have come to help and to serve. And we are well underway. It was a great week last week. And I only anticipate it getting better and better and better. So we are so looking forward to this week. Tuesday Night Live right here at 6 p.m. This Tuesday and every Tuesday. There's no routes here in July. But we ask that you come and be a part of our Tuesday Night Live. We have a meal today. We do have a meal today. And so after this, we'll ask that we can set up some table and chairs. DC? Yes. Yes, sir. So if we can get some volunteers right after we're done, head to this side. Dale's pointing the way. We're going to set up some tables and chairs right here in the auditorium. God loves you. And we love you too, and we hope to see you all very, very soon. Be blessed. Thank you.